gosh, this place is so beautiful.
I'm gonna do what we did.
Okay.
Or trip and die.
Any mattress?
Do we need a mattress?
Yes.
Heyo.
Hey.
Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey.
Hey. Hey. I'm Anna.
And I'm Mary.
So thank you so much for coming out here tonight. Thank you, Kimberly, and Holy Grounds, and Zizek Writers, and
all
and
of you beautiful people.
We're just going to gush.
We're going to gush.
But first, we're going to read from this book that is our little...
And I'm sorry, our press didn't have it ready for us to bring.
Tonight,
yeah.
You can go on their website and hanker them for it if you... want more. So Anna's going to read her title poem first, and then I'll read mine. And so I'm turning the page for her.
Oh, you have it. Thank you.
Look at you. Yeah.
So this is really special for us because we've been friends for 15 years. So we're besties. So thank you for, it's awesome because we get to share a lot of our life together. So this is kind of a nice
way to share our stories with you because we got stories.
We got stories. Okay, life forms. I can't stop thinking about how life forms, how molecules of water are carried on soaring asteroids that travel miles and miles, then crash into unwary planets, how tiny rovers scour a corner of the universe, find these distant bodies, and declare the possibility of life on other planets, how someone or anyone could be interested in my words.
And this is my title poem, Turn Around, Don't Drown. I changed my mind. Let's not do this. These words are maybe all I have to myself anymore. And once you pass them over, make of them what you will, file them into your own system of understanding things, I'm going to resent you forever. You'll probably see everything wrong in your mind's eye. Fill in the blanks with yourself, and it will only make me feel worse next time I see you. More alone, more pathetic. Before you turn the page, practice the smile you'll give the next time you see me on the street. Memorize the way your cheeks feel, like that, but stop squinting. You're hopeless. I'm gonna know you saw this, and I'm going to hate you. Who the fuck are you anyway?
All right, let's get funny. Let's talk about what we love to talk about the most. Boys. So this one's called Boys. Years ago in my mid-20s, months after my first marriage ended in divorce, I moved in with my best friend, who was also newly single. Yes. We were out almost 7 days a week getting dizzy in dark divey bars and sticky dance floors, looking for our soulmates and right now mates. We even made nicknames for them like Crush of Death, Band Boy, Ant Farm Boy, Bird Boy, Tall DJ, Ethers. They were the boys happy to date either one of us. And my favorite, Goth Boy, who was so goth he colored his lips with a Sharpie. And when he and my best friend went to do it, he pulled out a black condom. True story. We teased them, changed our names, sometimes our dresses in the bathrooms on double dates, just to see if they would notice. We thought we were so clever. And boys were so dumb. One evening, on a rare occasion when I stayed home, I received a knock on the door. Opened it to a dark-haired, cocoa-skinned, doe-eyed 16-year-old boy selling magazine subscriptions. He asked, "Are your parents home?" "My parents," I chuckled. "No, I'm 26. Wow. Not anymore. "Wow, you look really young. And pretty," he said confidently. "Oh, thanks," I said. "You probably have a boyfriend, huh?" he said. "A boyfriend?" I shook my head vehemently. "No, no." "Well then," he held up the magazine subscriptions and said, "I think we could help each other out."
Yeah. Yeah.
This one's about another form of a muse, I guess. It's called War Stories. I think everybody knows that, like that guy. Everyone has a story about Warren. How he quickly cleared a crowded room when he cut his foot dancing on a table, how blood made glistening red spider webs on the ceiling, and how he spent the rest of the night in a bathtub filled with murky red water. about the night when his band played the Whiskey A Go-Go and he asked for every special effect, lasers and smoke and lights, backing up his growling, tangy voice. We've all seen him fall and kick and punch, and we've seen him throw back shots only to immediately throw them up again. We've watched him dance in his Speedo, and we've watched each other watching him, laughing and sweating and loving it. In a salon in Long Beach, he tipped my chair back, put his fingers into my hair, and massaged my scalp with shampoo until goosebumps covered my arms and legs. I felt my eyelids float together and the world lift off, and when he used the nozzle to rinse, warm water spilled from the sink and ran all the way down my neck and my back until my shirt was completely soaked and my eyes were wide open.
This is not from the book. It's a newer one. But it's on the love tip. So this is for everyone that knows a wildcat or has loved a wildcat or maybe is a wildcat. So why did we domesticate a thing like love? There's a force that cannot be contained. If caged would be a clawed arm, bleeding neck, a thrashing until let free. It is a spotted crooked tail of the wildcat running the street, rummaging through garbage cans, the near miss of a moving tire, the loud hiss at a barking dog. It is not just the rubbing of legs, a flop and show of soft belly, not a jump in the arms, and a purr so loud you can feel a buzz in your chest. It is the slink of muscle, the sideways glance and flinch as you reach for it. It is the jump off a two-story building. It is traversing the underlings of cars, once cornered, black-rimmed, coppered eyes, large pupils staring hair on end. It is the backing away and watching the wildcat run the street and simply letting things be.
I read the wrong poem.
Wrong.
I'm gonna read about asparagus.
This is called Asparagus Number One. It looks like an alien poking its crown, always towards the sky, like it remembers home is just somewhere beyond the moon. And this one's tra-la-la. After a bottle of wine and rubbing my broken heart on him all night, I can only be mad 5 minutes at a time. And then of course asparagus too. I admit it, the first time I saw asparagus growing up out of the ground, I felt the same way the first time I saw a penis.
Vacant stare, lack of focus, incoherent speech, difficulty reasoning, concentrating, and performing everyday activities, inappropriate displays of emotion, changes in sleeping patterns. I thought I was just in love. Turns out, it was a concussion.
I told Sandy Snyder I like Robbie Bear. And I told her because I knew she would tell Brittany Higgins, who had broadcast it to the entire fourth grade class, and maybe some fifth graders. I was right. And I knew Robbie liked me too. I knew because he saved me a seat on the carpet right next to him for story time in the library, and I also knew he liked me because in music class, when I played Silver Bells on my recorder without any mistakes, he smiled at me and shook his jingle bells in my direction. It was too bad though. Because just about a week later, there was a new boy in my class, my neighborhood, and my heart. His name was Jay Wang, and he was even better at spelling than Robin Walker. And so, it was too bad when Robbie Bear came up to me during recess on the little part of the field where I used to search for four-leaf clovers. It was too bad when he called me over, and I walked away from the whispering girls to face him by the monkey bars. It was too bad when he said, "Will you be my girlfriend?" And I said, "I don't like you anymore." It was too bad when he punched me in the stomach, knocked the wind out of me, and left me laying in the grass, gasping for air.
Also true. So yeah, track record not so great, and I get what I deserve.
Okay, so sometimes, again, as best friends, we have a lot of shared experiences, and this is a, I'm going to read the first part of the same experience. We both wrote about it.
Okay. I think I was at a, like, maybe it had been an open mic in Long Beach, and I burst into tears as she reads this poem, and I'm like, I just wrote a poem about this the same day.
So I'm going to read mine. Yeah, basically the worst. So I'm going to read mine and she'll read hers. So this is called Static. The buildup of air pressure from the high-altitude Great Basin blasted dry, stinging winds that made our skin itch inside out. We sat at her dining table making Italian knot cookies for her grandmother's memorial. Each roll and twist of the dough charged electricity, cracking the kitchen sink. A porcelain shard fell onto the floor. The crash broke the silence between us. "What the fuck did you do?" her fiancé yelled from the living room. We stood up from our chairs, her hair on end, my back to the wall. Did you put a thing in it?
He's like, shit, I came out.
It's okay.
She looks after me, but then I still mess it up. That's what she did. Oh, she did put a look at, she put a marker here for me.
I was making cookies, is the name of mine. The thing is, I broke the kitchen counter looking for the vanilla extract. I was rummaging around, and a whole jar of olives bounced from the third shelf and smashed a counter tile in half. But I was making cookies, so I threw away the trash, wiped the counter off, and continued looking for the vanilla extract. I was making cookies, and the cookies had to be made, because I was making cookies, and there was a cookie deadline, and there was a dead grandmother, and I had to make my dead grandmother's cookies, because no one on this side of the country knows how to make them right except me and my dead grandmother, and she was dead and wouldn't be making any fucking cookies anymore. So I made the goddamn cookies, and you came in and yelled at me about breaking the counter and throwing away the missing chunk of tile and making a big scene and rummaging around the dumpster and coming back with it like it was some fucking prize. Well, I didn't give a flying fuck because I was making cookies.
We need musical instruments.
I know, just like a little.
We're gonna have to bring a kazoo next time.
Yeah, then I can have like a little Casio keyboard.
Good. And then we need a keyboard cap.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we bring a cap.
No, but that means a. Okay, that's like Oscar music. Okay. Evacuate. Oh. Okay, this next set is about
driving.
This set is about driving. Evacuate. Driving north on the 110, the sign reads 10 minutes to downtown, but I can only see black silhouettes of high-rises against the jack-o'-lantern sky. It looks and feels like dusk, not 8 a.m. A steady procession of headlights stream in the opposite direction, each car covered in the gray powdery debris of 100,000 acres of the Angeles National Forest, and the cremated remains of thousands of jobs, real estate mortgages, equal rights marriages. I can't help but wonder how many casualties won't make it on the news, and I can't help but wonder why I'm not escaping.
Okay,
I drive a lot. I like to sing in bands and play in bands, and I drive home a lot in the middle of the night. On the bridge to home, the blue lights suspended in the starless sky tell a story above the water. I follow the line they make with my eyes and avoid looking down at the endless industrial stripes, containers all lit up in dizzying rows. At the greatest height, I become terribly afraid gravity will forget about me and that my little car will float away into the dark sky. So I keep my eyes on those blue lights and keep all my thoughts towards home.
Oh yeah, we bring it down.
Sorry, we kind of burned out all our... Fun ones.
Yeah.
Come and read and get a free post-it. Still got it.
No.
Oh. Get two free post-its.
Just breaking stuff over there.
At least they're sticky after a while.
That's what she said.
Oh, not again.
not that game.
Sorry, I'm trying to give you some entertaining things. Okay. Okay, so, sorry. We have to get serious, too. All right. The first time I saw my mother after her first schizophrenic episode, she was sitting on a stiff brown bed at the end of a long, frosty room. She wore a wrinkled hospital gown that made her look like a tossed-aside ball of paper. It was the first time I rushed to hug her. It was the first time I ever saw her 4'9 body as being small. We came in through the window. Even though the front door was unlocked, we fell asleep watching the Zodiac Killer, teetered like zombies to our bedroom, drifted off. I woke ever so slightly to light fingertips stroking the inside of my thighs, drawing small circles at the edges of my panties, twisted moonlight sheets exposing my legs with goosebumps rising. I sighed into my pillow, pulled myself into strong arms, dizzy and dreaming, folded my fingers into my loves, and began to sink back to sleep. The soft touching began again, slowly. I felt myself turn to ice, crystallize, grind my eyes open and shatter at the sight of a hooded man crouched at the edge of our bed, a stranger with his hand between my legs.
These are our last two poems. Thank you again.
Thank you so much
for letting us share our stories.
Sun and moon.
No, we're gonna skip.
Oh, that's why it's the last one. Okay, great. Thank you. So we came all the way from Long Beach and we're loving it here. So thank you so much. Yeah. So this is my Long Beach poem. Transients. When I first moved to Long Beach, we didn't have a place to live. We stayed in a hotel that rented by the week. The heavily perfumed beds had nursing home stench all over them. When we turned the lights out, thousands of roaches scurried the walls. The only way I could keep my eyes closed was to imagine tiny tap shoes on their feet. Our first apartment was on the bad side of Cherry, just south of 4th Street. Liquor stores and laundromats on every corner. Wobbly people walked up and down our one-way street, drank from bottles wrapped in brown paper bags and black plastics, but none of them wore clean shirts. Our neighbors drank tequila and cervezas on the weekends, and so did we. Their mariachi howls masked the screaming that came out of our own place. Left and right, flashing lights took the neighbors away. One got shot in the alley right behind our apartment and died in your arms. Another burned her apartment up because she left a cigarette on the bed while drilling holes in the ceiling to hear the angels. Then there were all the cats. The sweet Siamese stray that got struck by a speeding car in front of me. Mama cat who never came home because she found somewhere better. Wise phoenix that got stuck under the tire of a sobbing neighbor. Fluffy pit that was killed by a pack of stray dogs. Hina that had kittens in the empty closet after he moved out. Thank you. I hate making turns. He says I need to look at the spaces. I flinch and try to ignore him. I hate making turns, especially at night, especially onto sunset. I try to tune him out, but since there are worms in my brain and I'm a little worried about pit sweat staining my dress, I listen to him this one time and he's right. I'm looking at each set of lights, speeding down the hill, imagining how it will feel when metal slams metal, and I'm not looking at the spaces at all. It's only in finding the right space to escape, to emerge, to make this turn. It's only then I'll get anywhere. This is what I do. I stare at the rows of palm trees, days and weeks and months, and shows on marquees,
books on shelves, friends laughing into coffee cups, and faces and names, and I forget there's an empty space waiting for me. This life is crowded and loud and relentless, and still there is space for me. Another round of applause for Mary and Anne. So many notes. Notes in the host's hands. Okay. Great. Terrific. Okay. So let's go move on to round two of the open mic. I see that it's filled up very nicely, and some late birds have flown in since. So let's see. First up, Emmanuel Nunez. Is he here?